Well, thank you, Heidi. Heidi is, as you know, part of our Law and Disorder program, and she clearly has the best voice of the three of us, which is Michael, myself, and Heidi. My wife referred to the Law and Disorder program with the interaction of Michael, myself, and Heidi as the left car talk, which sounds about right. In any case, when I looked at this program, I saw this ad that actually I placed with Heidi and Karen, and it has a picture of Michael Smith with some huge fish. It says he's also a hell of a fisherman. Now, I was going to open with a story about I'm going fishing tomorrow with his brother-in-law in Wisconsin, but Michael Smith is not coming with us, and there's a reason for that. We've taken him before. He always brings some big books, because if you know Michael, he reads a huge amount. And we wear these rubber suits, and we walk through the woods, and all of a sudden, while we're walking on the stream, there's no Michael to be found. And it takes about 30 minutes, and of course, he's reading a book, but then falls asleep in the high grass. And he's somewhere downstream. So no longer does Michael Smith fish with us any longer. In any case, and then he catches the biggest fish, but this is cheating. This is not fly fishing. This is nothing. Anyway, I've known Michael, Debbie, and Eli for 35 years. For a long time, they lived around the corner in the village. We then became closer as we started to edit books together. Heidi mentioned one of them, Who Killed Che, which was our latest Che book. There was an earlier one, which was the FBI-CIA file about Che. And the favorite line that Michael and I discovered in the book, you know, utterly racist, was an FBI agent who was, or an informant living in the camp with Che in the Sierra Maestra, saying, Che is very smart for a Latino. That's the level of our FBI. Anyway, that was book one. Book two was Who Killed Che, and by this time I was tired of it all, but Michael, as he does with incredible energy, went to Argentina and did the book opening with 25 interviews in 4 days, went to Cuba when they published it there a few weeks ago, again, dozens of interviews, went to the book fair, and because Cuba wants every person to have a book, they were selling the books for less than 50 cents. As I said, I've known him for a long time. Debbie was actually the editor of the first book. Another book, when I was in Cuba last week, and of course I thought about Michael, I go into a bookstore, and there's a book by Joe Slovo, there's The Diary of Che, and on top of that is a book Heidi mentioned, Michael's edited book of Bill Kunstler's speeches, The Emerging Police State. So Michael's material is pervasive around everywhere. One other book I should mention is Michael's Notebook for 60s Radicals. Now I looked, notebook of a lawyer's notebook for 60 radicals. What is it, Michael? What's the name?
Notebook of a 60s lawyer.
Okay, I couldn't find it today, but don't worry about that. Michael has boxes of them left. So feel free to ask Michael for a copy of that book. Maybe at a discount. And the book he's proudest of is the one he did with Debbie and Francis Golden, who was here, Imagine Living in a Socialist USA. And then, of course, I'd be remiss to not mention directly his politics. He's been a political person, as far as I can tell, certainly his whole life, and certainly since Wisconsin, where he went to school. Anyway, I'll end on this note. The other day I'm at the Brooklyn Folk Festival. It's run by Eli. It's an incredible event, which I recommend going to. And one of the great performances on Friday night was by a young musician named Blind Boy Paxton. And he's introducing himself, and he says, I'm so pleased that my ma and my pa are in the audience. And you know who he was referring to? He was referring to Debbie and Michael. And I want to end on saying, not just are Debbie and Michael Blind Boy Paxton's ma and pa, but in some way, they're the ma and pa of all of us. And I think that's the most amazing thing. And I always say that Michael would give anyone here the shirt off his back. And then I thought of the last little joke about that. I think he'd give anybody the shirt off his back, unless it was a shirt that had the face of Leon Trotsky on it. And on that note, I'm happy to have to introduce Jim, who's going to then talk about Michael a bit.
No matter which way the political winds are blowing, whether it might be to his advantage or not,
Michael Smith knows that revolutionary socialism is the way forward. That's his belief. That's all the wonderful writing that he's done, all the wonderful movement work that he's done, the work around Cuba, is all on behalf of that understood principle from which he never deviates. And lastly, not only will Michael give you the shirt off his back, I just wanted to comment on that, because it's true, of course. If you have Michael Smith as a friend, you have a friend for life. You have someone who will not only give you the shirt off his back, but will go to the ends of the earth if you need him to be there for you. And that's because he not only has that broad love of all humanity, but the love of the individuals as well. The love of the individuals. In fact, sometimes if you take a walk with Michael down the streets of New York, it can take a lot longer than you thought it was going to take, because I've never walked down the streets with him when you pass the homeless person and he didn't stop and put something in the cup and have a few words to say to that homeless person. The big picture, the small picture, the big crisis, the small needs, none of them escape this big-hearted guy, folks. So it's been my privilege to be his friend for all of these years. I honor you. I love you, Michael. You're the dearest man in my life. Let us all honor Michael Smith.
I'm here with my wife Debbie and my son Eli. I met Debbie 40 years ago on March 8th on International Women's Day. I'd organized a book party for a feminist anthropologist at NYU Law School, invited Debbie to come to it with me, and we've been together ever since. And I'm here with my son Eli, who is with his band, the Downhill Strugglers. They're going to play for you all. They play old-time music. This summer, they're going on a tour for the Library of Congress. They're playing the Newport Folk Festival, the Vancouver Festival, many others, and they're ending up at the Kennedy Center. So they're very good, and we're all in for a treat, and they play dance music, too, so I'm looking forward to that. Thank you, Eli. I came to New York from Detroit, where I was a member of a lawyer's guild firm in Detroit. Jim Lafferty, who had been the executive director of the lawyer's guild, was in the firm. Dennis James, also became the executive director of the lawyer's guild, was my partner. Dennis is here. Ron Riasti was in the firm. Ron was here, came from Detroit. Abdeen Jabara was in the firm. Abdeen is here. He's the husband of Hollywood Wigan. And our firm was regularly spied on by the Detroit political police. We used to break into our offices, go through our files, take photographs of us. And one of our partners, Dick Sobel, who was the vice president of the Lawyers Guild, brought a FOIA lawsuit, and we got the Detroit Secret Police dossier on our law firm. I want to read to you what they concluded, because I thought it was so flattering that my publisher actually used it as a blurb on the back of my book, Notebook of a 60s Lawyer, which is available in the back for $10.